This is Russ Andersson. In this tutorial, we're going to be running through the workflow from SynthEyes into After Effects, handling the lens distortion in this shot using lens workflow distortion setup number 2, where we're ultimately delivering distorted imagery to the end client. So we'll see what that means and how that goes as we do this. And we're going to start this process out with a 3D solve. And as is typical with these kind of aerial shots, you know, there are various things on the ground that are moving that can get picked up. And it's a good idea just to take those out ahead of time. So having done that, we can go to the solver panel. And we're going to tell it we want to calculate distortion and then run the solve. So we have an initial solve. It looks reasonable, so let's go ahead and run the tracker cleanup. And it does point out a couple of trackers along the edge there that are problematic. They kind of wipe against the buildings and against the edge of the image ultimately. I'll point out also that there are a lot of repeating textures in this shot, so that you need to watch out for cases where trackers jump from one window to the next or one floor to the next with this kind of material. So here we're just going to fix those trackers by deleting them. And now we can update the solve. And as we do that, you see the figure of merit is decreasing steadily. So this is our 3D solve now that's reasonably good. If we're going to do a lot of 3D stuff downstream in After Effects that's based on positioning things, at this point we should go and set up a coordinate system in SynthEyes so that anytime we retrack or adjust anything, we'll be having the same positioning of stuff down in After Effects. But in this particular case, we're going to be doing a little planar tracking, and the coordinate system isn't going to be crucial, so we're going to skip that. I'll point out, to set up the coordinate system, we'd probably set up a couple of supervised trackers along the building and maybe a couple spots on the ground and use them to build up an intentional specific coordinate system based on what we wanted to do. But we are going to skip that here. And let's move along now to the lens workflow part of this. So I'm going to select the option number 2 here, redistorted, which means that things are going to get redistorted to match the original footage. We'll just click OK. And as I do that, you see that now that we have a bunch of boundaries here, these borders, and in lens workflow number 1, borders like this are specifically eliminated. In workflow number 2, they're specifically created. And the point of that is to make sure that all the pixels here in the corners are still present in the image. And we need to have those present so that later when we go and redistort the footage, we have all these pixels available so that the final image, fills the entire frame and doesn't have boundaries or borders of its own. So that is our adjusted version of the shot. And we can now start thinking about doing the planar tracking. And I'll point out that the planar tracking relies on having shots with very low distortion. So if the shot is distorted like this one, you want to eliminate the distortion first, as we have done. Now, the first 3D solve has computed the field of view of the shot very accurately, and we want to use that for the planar tracking so that it matches up appropriately. And to do that, we're going to run a script that is down here in the planar tracking area. It's saved solved field of view as the known seed. And having done that, it is then available for use by the planar trackers. So I'm going to change my planar tracker to be a 3D known field of view. And at that point, I can start creating it. I'm just going to click on these corners up here. and work my way around. And those will automatically match up with the field of view of that we've computed from the 3D solve. So I've got that. They look a little kilter. Let's just adjust them slightly. And since there is quite a bit of detail, especially in the vertical direction, I'm going to go to the high detail mode of the planar tracker. And now we're ready to let it start tracking through the shot. And then eventually it starts wiping off the edge and goes, you know, a bit nuts. So we can go back and look and see where that happens. And now we'll just shut that guy off and lock it up. So there's our 3D solve. If we want to go back to the quad view, you can see that the planar tracker is moving around out here. And there's some particular scaling issues that have to do with why it's out there and not somewhere in there. That's kind of a more advanced topic. It's exactly the same issue that you have when you're doing moving object tracking. This is all kind of based on a optical illusion, the Honey, I Shrunk the Kids optical illusion, let's call it. But nonetheless, things are showing up in the right spots, and that's what we need here. So now we are ready to do the export to After Effects. So let's just, it's the After Effects JavaScript export. And we're running pretty much the default options here. And we are going to be firing up After Effects immediately and automatically. So that'll happen as soon as it wakes up. So there we have it in After Effects. And actually, you see, I did do one thing that was a little silly. So let's go and correct it, which is that I have all of the trackers being exported, and that wasn't a good idea. It just gives you, you know, 120 different additional layers in After Effects. So I just went to the coordinates panel, and I've turned off the exportable checkbox for all the trackers except for the planar tracker. And I'm using the Control-I, Command-I, to be able to invert the selection set to be able to do that. And now let's just go and run that export again. So there we go. That loads a lot faster in After Effects and gives us a much more tractable result. So, you know, here is our planar tracker sitting in After Effects. You can see it's a rather colorful thing. Let's go and adjust that a little bit to be able to show. What's going on? So, you see that we still have the boundaries here, those borders, the black borders, and this is basically the equivalent to the view that we had in SynthEyes. We can go and look in a little carefully. You know, here's our building and our planar tracker, all still nice and straight lines and everything in this particular comp. So this particular comp, you'll notice, is at a higher resolution, 2064 by 1162. The original footage is a 1280 by 1080 shot. So the workflow script has adjusted things to be able to make all this happen and try and preserve the accuracy of this whole process. And the footage is being distorted here in the After Effects environment using a SynthEyes supplied plugin that mimics the distortion process that is occurring in SynthEyes. So it's taken that footage, distorts it to match, and then we've got our different 3D environment things sitting on top, you know, just as we saw the 3D environment in After in SynthEyes, you know, there's the 3D environment in After Effects as well. And you can see our planar tracker moving around in the 3D environment here in After Effects as well. I guess it doesn't update those immediately. We do have the option, I'll point out, using a different export, to export that planar tracker as a 2D corner pin as well. But that's not what we're doing here. We're doing a full 3D export. So back to the distortion part of this. Let's go back to our different comps. And there's actually another comp present. And this one is much simpler. And it just takes the comp that we have that we were just playing with, and it composites it over top of the original footage. And part of the trick to this, let's see, you go back to this guy, and here's the footage at the bottom. You can turn that off. Now we go back to the other comp, and now we're seeing the objects from the 3D environment. Here it's this, you know, this layer, and it's being composited back over top of the original footage. And in the process, if we take a look at this in some more detail, you know, you see that it still matches up, even though my 3D imagery, the stuff added in 3D, has now been distorted to match the original footage. So by using this multi-step process, these two different comps, I'm comping the 3D stuff onto the original footage and avoiding the resampling loss and softness that is introduced anytime you go and resample an image to distort it, undistort it, or do whatever to it. So this gives you the cleanest possible results with this kind of multi-step process. And some clients want this kind of distorted looking footage in the first place. So that's a decision that's up to the client, whether they want nice, clean, crisp looking footage that has everything being all nice and straight, or that whether they want to preserve the distortion that was present in the original image. And I'll give you an example. That's, you know, that's the guys that are putting things out on YouTube. Look at this incredible stunt that just happened. And meanwhile, you've got a little visual effects work sitting in the background, and you want to preserve the look of the, you know, the distorted lens that sells the idea that it's still some crappy shot that just had something incredible happening. So this hopefully gives you an idea of what this multi-pass workflow is about. You know, no question, it's a bit more complicated, but you know, it's what it takes to get the job done in the way that people want it. So hope that helps you out. Take care.